So let's start it off. Welcome to the Reformed Church of Los Angeles. May the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us worship God, who has done great things.
We rejoice in our God, who made a way through the desert of this world.
Let us worship God, who has caused streams of mercy to flow in the wasteland.
We are the people God has formed through Christ. We worship him, and we rejoice.
Let us worship God in spirit and in truth.
We praise God for the grace that he has saved us. Alleluia, we rejoice.
Please join me in a word of prayer. Almighty and ever-present God, as we turn toward the promise of a new year, allow us to look back and to look ahead, to see places in the past where your promises have upheld us, and to look to an unknown future with confidence and trust in you, in the strong name of Christ we pray. Amen.
Good afternoon, family and friends. Could you do me a favor? Please look to your neighbor and tell them that I am glad to see you in the house of the Lord.
I'm glad to see you in the house of the Lord.
Make a joyful noise to the Lord all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. This is out of Psalms 100. Family and friends, please stand as we prepare to praise our Heavenly Father.
You lay down your life. God, for because he is good. Amen? He is good. He is great. He's given everything that we have, the breath in our lungs, the energy to raise our hands, lift our voices, lift our hearts, and honor his great name. Amen?
To honor the way to go.
may be seated. Gracious God, as we draw to the close of this year and claim the year ahead, our Father, we need to confess to you the pieces of the past that persist in pulling us backwards. Through admitting our failures and sharing our sin, we would like to put away those things that nibble and nag, de-energize and depress. With boldness, then, and a certain measure of embarrassment, we admit to squandering time and talent, good intentions and better ideas, opportunities for growth and occasions for grace. We admit that most often we have taken care of ourselves while others have stood in line. We have defined our interests carefully and our goals precisely, using energy and expertise gainfully to the detriment of our family, our friends, our community, and even our church. We agonize with memories that sit heavily and images that cause us to blush. And we ask that you would grant us your forgiveness as we confess our individual regrets and remorse in silence through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Family, we now have the opportunity to come before God and one another and confess our sins. Please take a moment of silent confession before God and one another. Family, hear these comforting words. If you repent and believe in God's redeeming mercy, your sins are forgiven. Trust in God's promises and begin a new year life with God and all God's people in the name of Jesus Christ.
Praise God, whom all blessings flow.
And now, family, we state precisely what we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed. Please follow along with the words on your screen. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sin, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. And now we continue with our Westminster Shorter Catechism, and we continue our exposition of the Ten Commandments or the Moral Law. And this week in question 71, we ask, what is required in the seventh commandment? Answer, the seventh commandment requires us to preserve our own and our neighbor's chastity in heart, speech, and behavior. 1 Thessalonians 4:3-5 says, for this is the will of God, your sanctification, that you abstain from sexual immorality, that each one of you know how to control his own body in holiness and honor, not in the passion of lust like the Gentiles who do not know God. And again, this commandment not only forbids adultery, but in actuality, in the Greek, the word for that's used for adultery is porneia. We are to avoid porneia, which is where we get our word for pornography and any other sexual lust or impurity that is outside of marriage. And so just because you're not committing adultery doesn't mean you're off the hook. It's important that we pay attention to what we look at, to what we listen to, and even the things we say, because all of those things fall under sexual immorality. And I pray that we would be people who reflect the fact that our minds have been washed and cleansed by the blood of Christ, and that we have been made pure in His sight, and that we would actually live that out. Amen.
and family.
Yeah, I do.
And welcome to RCLA Reformed Church of Los Angeles. We're glad that you're here to worship the resurrected Christ with us today. If you're new or brought a guest, please stop by our welcome center at the entrance. We'd love to meet you, and you can provide a name and contact info on the back of the bulletin. We really appreciate it. The bulletin is the best way for us to get to know you. So if you have a prayer request or a praise report, please write it in the back and place it in the offering basket. We'd love to know how to pray for you or how to give God praise for you. If you're interested in getting connected, serving, or growing spiritually, let us know in the back of the bulletin and place it in the offering basket as well. Family, please help me in thanking our RCLA kids that were a part of the Christmas play this past Wednesday. So if you're
with you, Chris.
Wonderful children, may we continue to be
guidance for them with your love and with your guidance, Lord. And we just ask for your blessings. We ask this in your name. Amen. Okay, so no Sunday school kids, so please remember to go back with your families. And now as we continue our time of worship with the giving of our tithes and offerings, hear this from Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's, and all that is in it, the world, and those who live in it. Remember that all we have is God's, and he lets us manage what he's given us. So let us manage it well and give back to him for his church and ministry. If you have given electronically, there is a portion of the back of the bulletin to tear off and deposit in the offering basket. So if you don't have anything today, as I never carry anything with me, remember that you can give online. Go to the RCLA website and there is a portion where you click. And it's a little different, so you have to click partner with us, and then on there you'll have, there'll be the donate button. So please give as you are led.
Be thou my lead, O Lord. Thank you.
book of Isaiah commences with the vision given to him, Lord, may we too look to you. Be thou our vision, to see through your eyes. Be thou our wisdom, that we discern according to your will. Be thou our inheritance. Be thou first in our hearts. Be thou our everything, O ruler of all. And Lord, as we come to the final service of this 2019, may we pause, God. May we reflect, Lord, and not just remember, but be remembered into your body, to be remembered into Christ. Lord, if we fall away, gently draw us in. If we've blown it completely and tried to have our way this last year, Lord, forgive us. If we've gotten too big-headed, Father, humble us with comfort and remind us that nothing we do good is in and of our own selves. But you are who are the giver of all things, gives. In Christ's name we pray. And every last person in this room with a loud voice said,
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Good morning, family.
Good morning. Happy.
Oh, just checking to see if you're awake. We're now just a few days past Christmas, right? And many of us are still talking about how we spent it with family, with friends, with loved ones, playing games, sleeping, drinking. Some of y'all too much drinking. Talking about the presents we got or complaining about the presents that we didn't get. Some of us are really thankful for all the great food we ate. And other of us are complaining because our clothes just don't fit anymore because of all the good food we ate. And we start blaming people and say that they stuck their clothes in the dryer, right? Was that just me? Am I the only one that thinks that? Most of you know my story, so I'm not going to get into the details. But after more than 20 years of being involved with gangs, drugs, and violence, when I got saved, it wasn't really easy to get over some of the stuff that I've done in the past. As a matter of fact, some of it still haunts me to this day. I was involved with the recovery ministry for many years, both in prison and outside of the church that we used to be a part of. What is it like for somebody to have broken clean from their addictions and all the bad stuff and choices they were doing in their lives? Even when you get clean, like, it's like you're no longer using and we're clean, but how do you get rid of the bad habits? Now that we believe in Jesus, how do you get past our past? Well, it's not easy a thing to do. There's being honest, like brutally honest inventory, going and making amends with all the people that we've hurt in the past and ask them to forgive us, and when necessary, for us to extend forgiveness to those people that have hurt us. One of the key reasons of dealing with our past is because we can't keep our eyes on the road ahead if we're too busy looking at the rearview mirror to see what's in the back. If we continue looking in the rearview mirror, we're going to end up crashing, right? And miss what's in front of us. Now, that doesn't mean that we pretend like what happened in the past didn't happen. But we don't let it hold us back. When we have communion every Sunday, you'll often hear Pastor Chris or myself invite you to run your hands through the baptismal font. Why? Because that is where our identity is. Our identity is in the resurrected Christ and what he did on the cross. It's not your mistakes. It's not your past addictions or how much money you have in your bank account, what kind of education you have or don't have. Our identity is in the risen Savior. Now, we can be really good at holding on to the past. We can be really good at kicking ourselves in the butt and forgiving everyone in the world except ourselves. But God tells us to let go of the past. He gives us instructions to not dwell on what happened in the past. Not just the things that we've done, but even some of the things that he's done. With that said, if you would please open up your Bibles to the book of the prophet Isaiah, chapter 43. We'll be reading from verses 14 through 19. Isaiah 43, starting at verse 14. When you have it, if you're able to stand in body or in spirit for the reading of the Lord's word, we'd really appreciate it. Isaiah 43, give me a loud amen over there.
Amen.
And the word of God reads as follows. Thus says the Lord, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, for your sake I send to Babylon and bring them all down as fugitives, even the Chaldeans and the ships in which they rejoice. I am the Lord your Holy One, the Creator of Israel, your King. Thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea, a path in the mighty waters? Who brings forth chariot and horse, army and warrior? They lie down, they cannot rise, they are extinguished, quenched like a wick. Remember not the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs forth, do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. People of God, this is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated, family. You got the scriptures on? You don't have them? I'll get to them. As I was saying, today is our last Sunday. It's our last Sunday of the year. Think about that, our very last worship service of 2019. Next Sunday, when we come back together, it'll not just be a new year, but a new decade. Crazy, huh? How many of you already have your New Year's resolutions ready? Nobody? This is the house of the Lord, you can't be lying. Who has your New Year's resolution? Don't start saying it, but I know I got my New Year's resolutions ready. Now, a more sincere question. How many of them are exactly the same as last year? And the year before? And the year before? Today, there are people in churches across the world being fed lies. Being prophesied over, people telling them that next year is going to be their year of increase. It's going to be their year of breakthrough. It's going to be your year of financial gain. It's going to be your year of victory. It's going to be your year of fill in the blank. The Bible doesn't say anywhere that on January 1st of each year, things will change for you. That things will get better for you because it's a new year. What will happen is if we start eating healthier, if we start working out, we're going to lose weight and get in shape. If you work hard and diligently at your job, you'll probably get a promotion and a raise. If you stay in school and study hard when you graduate, you'll probably be a better candidate for your dream job. If you stop messing with toxic people, you'll stay sucker-free and avoid toxic relationships. It's easy math. And listen to this. If we stop being selfish and thinking only of ourselves, if we start thinking more about God, reading His Word, being obedient to His commands, fasting and praying and loving our neighbors as ourselves and being generous with what we've been entrusted to steward, I'm almost positive that I can tell you that we will have the favor of God. Not saved through those things. That only comes through faith. But I promise you, if you draw near to God, He will draw near to you. Yeah. Matthew 6:33, don't believe me. But seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Isaiah 55:6 says, seek the Lord while He may be found. Call upon Him while He is near. Let us try doing these things instead this year. Let us seek God first in all things. Let us truly seek the Lord's presence in every situation. Not just the difficult ones that you think you can't handle. Let us truly seek God's righteousness in every aspect of our lives. Not just the ones that we're proud of. And by all means, let us forget the things of the past and look towards the things of the future. Let us be forgetting what lies behind and straining forward towards what lies ahead. Let us press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Amen? Amen. You see, the Israelites had a problem. They kept focusing on the problems of the past. Can anybody relate to that? Is anybody so caught up in their past that they just can't seem to break free from it? Now, they kept messing up, so God continued to remind them, right? But they had even a hard time forgetting the good things that God had done. And that would eventually hinder them from being able to see what God could do in the future. Let me explain the context of our scripture today. Isaiah 39, King Hezekiah makes a bonehead decision and shows the Babylonians all his wealth and all their armor and weapons. And Isaiah tells him, you messed up, bro. God will send you into captivity for your foolishness. Isaiah 40, we hear the famous words that remind us that the grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of God will stand forever. And that those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. Isaiah 41, Israel is reminded, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. In Isaiah 42, the Lord reminds Israel of their election and that he will keep them. And he says, behold, the former things have come to pass, and new things I now declare. And in chapter 43, he starts to comfort them by saying, fear not, I have redeemed you. I have called you by my name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And then we come to verses 14 through 19. Let me read them again. Thus says the Lord, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. For your sake, I sent to Babylon and bring them all down as fugitives, even the Chaldeans in the ships in which they rejoice. I am the Lord, your Holy One, the Creator of Israel, your King. Thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea, a path in the mighty waters, who brings forth chariot, the horse, army, and warrior. They lie down, they cannot rise, they are extinguished, quenched like a wick. Listen to this. Remember not the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I am doing a new thing. Do you know what God is talking about here? He's making reference to the Exodus, bringing them across the Red Sea and through those waters. God extinguished horse, chariots, warriors, and the Bible says that he quenched them like a wick. And then he tells them, forget about those things. Forget about the things that I've done for you in the past. Stop contemplating on them. Why? Because he's going to do something bigger still. He's going to do something even bigger, much bigger. He's mightier than that. But they probably won't see it if they're still hanging on to what he did in the Exodus. Don't get me wrong, that was a really good thing. And we should think about the good things that God has done in our lives. But not contemplate on them over and over again. That's the only thing he's ever done, and that's the only thing he ever will do. And that's what I want to focus on teaching today, is that as we conclude 2019, focus not so much on the past, but instead on what's to come and what your role is in that. The past doesn't rule us, family, unless we let it. Although the passage is not necessarily talking about forgetting the things that you or I have done wrong, in the past it can totally be used for practical application today. But if God has done a great thing for you, that doesn't mean you neglect doing other things for yourself either, or seeking God for bigger and better things that he'll do to you or through you. What do I mean? Let me give you an example. I've got a really good friend, actually one of my compadres. He had stomach cancer. Remember, he went to the church, we used to be a part of it, and we prayed for him, we laid hands, and he underwent treatment, and God used that to heal him. During treatment, he wasn't drinking, he wasn't smoking, he was eating healthy, doing all the things he had never done before. But when he got healed, he went back to drinking. He went back to smoking, and I couldn't believe it. Now, we can't expect God to save us from something, and then run him up like heathens like that never ever happened. We can't expect God to have gotten us out of a situation, and then do nothing to avoid getting into another one. It doesn't work that way. Forget what's happened in the past. Don't dwell or contemplate on the great things that you've done, the bad things that you've done, or even the things that God has done for you. Tomorrow is a new day. Work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. You don't drop 20 pounds and start eating messed up and expect not to gain it back, right? Believe me, I dropped 19 pounds and gained 21 back. Do the math, I know what I'm talking about. When it comes to God, he's no joke. He is not the kind of person we want to play with. So as we come to the end of 2019, forget about what's happened in the past. At least those things that will hold you back from making progress in your life. And as much as it applies to your health and to your wealth and your weight and to relationships and your job and financial status, I'd say let's focus more on our spiritual lives. Amen? There's nothing more important than that. Sure, do all the other things that are good for us, right? But that's all temporal. Looking good is great, but it's temporary. Our weight will not help us when we're standing before God in judgment. Our bank account won't help us to be forgiven for every careless word or deed when we're standing being judged. But you know what will come? Our faith in Jesus. Our faith in Christ. That is a game changer. That's what's important. Focus not so much on the past, but instead on what's to come and what our role is in it. We need to ask ourselves, what do we need to leave behind in 2019? Whether you like it or not, what just didn't work? What was time-consuming that just didn't give you the benefits that you were looking for? What must you start doing in 2020 that you've been holding off on? Can I give you a few suggestions? I'm going to give them to you anyways. The first one is this. Seek the Lord with passion. Amen. Do the gym thing. Do the finance thing. Like, do all that. But seek the Lord with passion. And the second is serve the Lord with passion. Seek him and serve him with passion. Where are your toes at? Watch out. Give to the Lord with passion. Seek the Lord, serve the Lord, and give to the Lord with passion. Seek to the Lord. 1 Chronicles 16:11 says, seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his presence continually, not just the first few weeks of January, not just when you're in trouble, not when you feel like everything's falling down around you. Yes, those times, but even when things are good. Even the last Sunday in December. Do you seek the Lord continually? Or only when you feel like you can no longer do things on your own? Proverbs 8:17 says, I love those who love me, and those who seek me diligently find me. The Lord says clearly that if we seek him, if we love him, we will find him. It's simple enough math. Seek him with passion, diligently. He will be found. He will not play hide and seek with you. How about prayer? Not just a 10-second prayer before meals, although those are good. Not just a help me Jesus when you're about to walk into an important appointment. Not just a fix it Jesus when you're getting ready to go off on somebody. Those are good, but those shouldn't be the only prayers that we have. If that's all we're doing, we're being lazy and we're being selfish. Treating God like if he was a genie lamp. If he was Santa Claus, Jesus, give me, give me, give me, give me. And we're giving him our list every day of things that we want him to give us. We need to devote time to him like we do to sporting events. We need to devote time to him like if he's a Raider game and you want no interruptions. You know what I'm talking about? Your favorite NFL team, NBA team, MLB team, when you don't want anybody harassing you. We need to devote time to him like when we get lost on our phone watching videos and people are trying to grab our attention because we're stuck on our phones. We need to devote time to the Lord waiting on him too. We need to wait on him. Can I tell you a secret? Another one? It's not about you. And it's not about me. It's about him. Everything we do, everything we see, everything we read this morning is about him. The minute it becomes about us, it's messed up. Psalm 27:14 says, wait for the Lord, be strong, and let your heart take courage. Again, wait for the Lord. Friends, God doesn't need your help. He doesn't need my help. He is the creator of all things. We are privileged that we get to work for him, we get to work with him, to spread his gospel, to love all people in his name. We get to do that. He doesn't need us. wait on the Lord, seek the Lord with passion, which leads us to serving the Lord with passion. Matthew 6:24 says, no one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he'll be devoted to the one and despise the other. Sometimes money is something that we serve. We're not just trying to provide for our family. We are serving money. Make sure it's Christ that we're serving and not ourselves. All too often we can think that we're serving God, but in reality, it's ourselves that we're serving. We serve the Lord and serve his people, not because it's a nice thing to do, but because he came to serve. He modeled it out. He gave us the way to do it. Mark 10:45, for even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve. One of the best things, again, I repeat to her, is it's not about us. It's all about him. It's sad that for many of us who are selfish, we only think of ourselves and not of others. And I say we, not you, we. We'll just serve enough to be able to say, I helped out. But deep down, we know we can do so much more. So much better, with so much more passion. How do we serve the Lord with passion? We serve him by serving his church. That's why church membership is so important. Because we commit to serving the Lord through the local church. We submit ourselves to the authority and oversight of the church elders. We lead, we teach, we set up, we tear down, we clean, we cook, we take out trash, we wash dishes, we do whatever needs to be done as if unto the Lord. Amen? We do whatever needs to be did. You hear that? We need to do whatever needs to be did. That's going to be on YouTube in a whole group or somewhere, right? Family, we do whatever needs to be done in the name of Jesus. Free English lesson of the day, right? And the third is the hardest one of all. We got to give to the Lord with passion. With passion. We seek the Lord with passion. We serve the Lord with passion. And we give to the Lord with passion. And some of you say, well, up until here you had me. Why do churches always have to talk about money? Actually, I hadn't even mentioned money yet. But yeah, I'm going to talk about money. The moment we hear about giving, we always assume it's money, money, money. No, it's not only money. It's giving of yourself. It's giving of your gifts. It's giving of your talents. It's serving and giving of ourselves with passion. I'm talking about generosity as a whole. Money is very important, but money isn't everything. In the same way we tell you, during the tithes and offering, to give joyfully, generously, and sacrificially, that also applies to ourselves. One of the quickest ways to disprove our faith in God is to think that he will not provide for our needs. There's a parable of a widow who had 2 pennies and threw them into the offering to teach us it's not about how much you have, right? It's about what you're willing to give. Philippians 4:19 says, and my God will supply every need of yours according to his glory in Christ Jesus. We may not have everything we want, but we're going to have everything we need. And if I can share something more personal with you, can I, church? Yeah, I'm going to tell you anyways. You would think that as we continue to move forward, that our church would be able to give more and more, right? To help meet our financial needs, to keep the doors open. But it hasn't. People just aren't giving. On one hand, it's concerning as a pastor, not just because it makes it hard to keep our doors open, right? Continue to do the things that we feel God has called us to do, but because it shows that our church is very immature in our faith. Our lack of giving shows that we don't trust God. At the end of each service, pay attention to this. Pastor Chris or myself will ask you to do what? Stand and open your hands, right? To receive this blessing. Not from him, not from me, but from the Lord. With his word, through his word. Can you receive a blessing with a closed fist? No, right? You say, open up your hands and receive this blessing from the Lord. You cannot receive something with a closed fist. Yet that's how many of us act towards God when it comes to our money. We clench up our fist and think it's ours. He's God, he'll take care of it. And you know what? He will. He will. But what does that say about us? That the one who gave everything for us is not worthy of us giving a portion back to him, but what he's generously given. We can remember all the scripture in the Bible that has to do with receiving God's blessings. All the scripture that has to do with receiving healing. All the scripture that has to do with being forgiven and His mercy and grace extended towards us. When it comes to scriptures about giving to others, we kind of forget those. Those aren't that important. Acts 20:35 says, remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how He Himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. And Proverbs 11:24-25 says, one gives freely, yet grows all the richer. Another withholds what he should give and only suffers want. Whoever brings blessing will be enriched. And one who waters will himself be watered. Family, we're not here to tell you to give, because if you give to God, He will give you more. That's boo-boo, that's not true. That's called prosperity. I can stand here, Pastor Chris can stand here and preach a sermon and pick all kinds of scripture to convince you that the more money you give, the more money, the more that the Lord will bless you. That's not accurate. But there is a certain mystery in trusting God when He says in Malachi 3:10, bring the full tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. And listen to this, and thereby put me to the test. Put me to the test, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open the windows of heaven for you and pour down for you a blessing. Now there are many a pastor who will twist those scriptures up for their convenience. That's not us, but there is a mystery of trusting the Lord with everything that He's given us. We can't outgive God. There is no way you can outgive the one who already gave everything for you. So this isn't a guilt trip. It's a reality check. If you begin to make excuses when it comes to giving, when it comes to lending a helping hand, when it comes to giving some of your right, check yourself. If you have a hard time when it comes times to tithes and offerings, don't check your bank account, check your heart. When we are called to give joyfully, generously, and sacrificially of our money, our gifts, and our talents. Although we're just past Christmas, enjoy your gifts, but don't neglect the greatest gift ever. A.W. Tozer said, the more fascinated we become with the toys of this world, the more we forget that there's another world to come. Family, focus not so much on the past, but instead on what's to come and what your role is in that. Forget the past mistakes you made. Forget the things that didn't work for you. And don't even contemplate some of the things that God has done for you already. Because He said, behold, He is doing a new thing. But the one thing you must never forget that God has done for you is the gospel. You must never forget that Christ came to die that we might live. You must never forget how much God loves us. You must never forget what He saved us from. You must never forget the cross where He bled and died to cleanse us and save us from ourselves. Never forget how much God loves you. Never forget what He has already given for you. Be reminded, family, as we enter 2020, that He is always doing a new thing. And as we conclude our final service for the year, remember to seek the Lord with passion. Serve the Lord with passion. And give to the Lord with passion. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray. Father, we thank You for the greatest gift You can ever give. You gave Your Son. Your only Son, who lived a perfect life that we never could live. He was tempted in every way we were, yet He never sinned. And He willingly went to a cross. You let Him willingly go to a cross to die a death that was meant for us, so that if anybody should place their faith in Him, anybody, you would be saved. Father, let us forget the greatest gift You have ever given us. Let us always come to You with open hands, not just to receive, but to give of ourselves, our marriages, our families, our careers, our vocations, all those things that You have given us, our health to serve You and to love You. And we always seek You, Lord, when things are good and when things are bad and when things are in between. And as we come to a close, let us be reminded and reflect on all those things we did wrong this year. We would repent from them. It would make amends where necessary, starting and ending with You, because we love You. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
And now, family, let us remember that there is nothing made new without this blood that we celebrate. It is the blood of the new covenant that is the foundation, the reason, and the cause of the fact that God is now a God of a trillion chances, that we can come to Him an infinite number of times and He can renew us all because of the sacrifice of His Son Jesus on the cross for our sins. And so, hear now the words of the institution of that supper, where the Apostle Paul tells us, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. On the night when He was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread, and when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way also, He took the cup after supper and said, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.' For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes. So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sin against the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself in this way. Let him eat the bread and drink from the cup. For whoever eats and drinks without recognizing the body eats and drinks judgment on himself." And so as we end this year, conclude this year, when we come to this final Lord's Supper in 2019, let us truly keep in mind the fact that this blood has truly erased our past. That it's truly, God has truly forgotten our sins, cast our sins as far as east is from the west. He's cast it into the ocean of forgetfulness, never to be found again. Let us celebrate that, because that's better than having your debt erased, your credit, having whatever part of your greatest need is to be saved, because that determines where you will spend eternity. And so let us keep that in mind as we come forward. And let us take this seriously and take a moment of silent confession just one more time this year before God and one another. Holy Spirit, thank you for taking this blood and applying it to our lives. Thank you, Holy Spirit, that you confirm to us that the blood of Jesus is sufficient to forgive all of our trespasses, all of our sins, all of our iniquities, anything and everything that has not been pleasing to our Heavenly Father. You have applied to us in such a way that that is no more. We thank you for the new birth, more so than a new year. We thank you that we don't need to wait till January for a new beginning, for a new chance. We thank you that resolutions don't need to end on January 1st. We can start anew in February, in March, in April, all because of what Christ has done for us. We thank you, we love you, we praise you. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. And now this bread which we break is sharing in the body of Christ. And the cup for which we give thanks is sharing in the blood of Christ. As always, you will come forward, drink a single file of wine from either the blue chalice, which has wine in it, or the white chalice, which has grape juice.
Thank you.